This is Ambition Today. Not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road. What's up, world? My name is Kevin Siskar, and this is Ambition Today, where we discuss with ambitious and entrepreneurial people what it means to be the most awesome people alive. We unlock the secret ways in which you can achieve success, grow your startup, accomplish your goals, and try to change the world today. Last episode, we talked to Adam Bezvinnik, venture capitalist at Deep Fork Capital, about how he hustled his way into his incredible career as a venture capitalist and how he broke into that dream role. This episode was one of the top episodes last week on Product Hunt. Definitely go check it out. Today we are joined by guest Patrick McGinnis, author of The 10% Entrepreneur. Podcast reviews are one of the main ways shows move up in the iTunes store. If you enjoy this show, then please visit siskar.co/review right now. I've made it super simple, and there's a 3 clicks to leave your review from that domain. Thank you so much for all the help, and we love that you listen to the show. Today's episode of Ambition Today is brought to you by Top Tail. Visit toptail.com/ambition today to hire the top 3% of freelancers from a growing network of the best custom software developers and designers. If you haven't got your free Ambition Today stickers, you need to go get them today. Listen in during the break for the promo code to get your stickers, and then send us a pic of where you snap them. This is Ambition Today.
Looking to make your dreams come true? Needing that extra push to become more successful? Then you've come to the right place. Welcome to Ambition Today with your host, Kevin Siskar.
What's up, world? You are listening to Ambition Today. I am your host, Kevin Siskar. You can find me on Twitter at the Siskar, and I blog about startups, technology, and life at www.siskar.co, also the home of Ambition Today. On today's episode, we are joined by Patrick McGinnis, author of The 10% Entrepreneur, also managing partner at Dirigo Advisors. Patrick, welcome to Ambition Today.
Thanks for having me, Kevin.
Thanks for coming out. It's a beautiful day in New York. New York weather's been pretty good lately, huh?
This is definitely allergy season, though, so if you hear me start to sneeze, you know, forgive me.
No worries. I took a Claritin this morning, so we should be good. Once again, we're ready to dissect ambition and success for the sake of entrepreneurial science. So you had an upbringing in Maine, correct?
Right.
So what was that? What was that like growing up there? Small town, blue collar, what was it like?
It was great. So I come from a small town called Sanford. You may know us by our 5 Dunkin' Donuts. We have the highest Dunkin' Donuts per capita in Northern New England.
Nice.
It was a small town. It was a great place to grow up. Basically, you know, my parents grew up there. My grandparents moved there from Quebec when they were, you know, in the 1920s. And it was a really sort of blue collar town. So it was the kind of place where my dad worked for the government at a naval shipyard. My mom worked for a small company nearby. Everybody went to public school. And it was very, I would say, wholesome, a nice place to grow up, but a difficult place to sort of leave in terms of, we didn't have a lot of, let's say, AP classes and things like that at our high school. So you sort of had to hustle if you wanted to find your way into a good school.
So what was the strongest lesson from your time there that you kind of still carry with you today?
I think the number one lesson that was instilled in me and many of my friends and peers was all about hard work. So if somebody was nice or well-respected around town, the typical thing that people would say about them is that they were a super hard worker. And so the value of hard work was established in us from a very early age. And so I learned, you know, from the beginning, I had tons of jobs during the summer. I did, you know, gardening and mowing lawns, and I had a newspaper route, and I worked every summer. I mean, it was just it was what you did there. And so I was never afraid of kind of getting my hands dirty and doing work.
I love that. I love the working even from a young age just to get what you needed.
Definitely. I mean, we had to save up our money to be able to, we had everything we needed, but there was not a lot of extra to go around for silliness. So we sort of like, I sound like an old fogey right now, but but it's funny because like, I just remember in the, you know, we would just save up every penny we did. And I worked all year round to do that.
What was the first big thing you like saved up for?
That's a great question. Probably I saved up to buy like a stereo or a TV in my room or something like that.
That's awesome. So then you left Maine and you went to Georgetown.
Right.
So what was leaving like? What was your time at Georgetown like? What did you study there?
So I love Georgetown. Georgetown was my number one choice. I applied early and I had never really left home. So it was a big deal for me. And my high school only sent one person ever before to Georgetown. So when I applied, my guidance counselor, she wasn't trying to be discouraging, but she said, I hope you have a backup school.
Oh boy.
Which I did. I had a backup school, but I ended up getting in. And so I went there and it was a bit of a culture shock because my roommate, who's came from a wealthy suburb of Kansas City, showed up with like all this J. Crew stuff, and he would like buy it directly from the catalog. And I had never bought anything full price in my life. We were used to going to the outlets in Freeport, Maine. And so I was astonished by the wealth of my classmates. And also, I didn't really even sort of know how to recognize the wealth. So I'd never knew what an Audi was, for example. And so when I saw them around campus, I was like, well, that's a car I've never seen before. So I was a little bit, you know, fresh off the boat from rural America, as it were, but I love Georgetown. I found it to be an extraordinarily welcoming place. I've met amazing people there. Being in Washington was fantastic. I worked for my representative, and then I was in the School of Foreign Service studying international economics. And so that put me on a path to building a really international career. And it really changed sort of my entire narrative and sort of who I was as a person.
Yeah. And I think it's a small step that you jumped over there, but you had to overcome that the think small mentality when you left, right? Like your guidance counselor was like, you may not get there. That's pretty ambitious of you, right? But,
precisely.
You know, that's kind of one of the themes of the show, is that overcoming those obstacles as they approach, and they don't always look the same. Sometimes they're just so ingrained in the culture, you don't even recognize them. But once you're on the other side, you look back and it's just so obvious, right? So international economics, you ended up in Argentina through that, right?
I did. So when I was a sophomore, I applied for the scholarship from the Rotary Foundation and I won it. And so what that represented was an entire year paid for by Rotary in Argentina. So they covered my tuition, all my living expenses, like my travel, everything. And I had never left the country. I was 21 years old.
Yeah, so you went from leaving small town to Washington, D.C., to leaving the country pretty fast.
Yeah, I remember I was at Logan Airport and getting on the plane, and I absolutely freaked out. I just didn't know what I was going to do. I was so afraid, and I was going on my own, and my Spanish was más o menos, as we would say in Spanish. And I got off the plane there, and I actually was very overwhelmed by the experience. But in the next year, I basically backpacked from Bogota, Colombia, back to Buenos Aires. I went to every country in Latin America or in South America. I learned Spanish. It was a huge, I came back wearing like tight pants and leather jackets and, you know, thinking I was like some sort of like Latino. It was a pretty extreme transformation.
So what value do you think? So I think there's two questions here. So there's what value do you think traveling brings to people? And what value do you think living in other cultures brings to people? Because you were there a year, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, I was. And I think that the travel question is such a good one because I travel a lot. I've been to a little over 70 countries by now.
Wow.
Yeah, and I like to go places that are a little off the beaten path. So last year I was in Kyrgyzstan and Armenia and Georgia, and I've been to a bunch of other places that are different, let's say. And the reason why I do that is because I had this experience traveling when I was in Latin America in college, where I had been in a very safe environment my entire life, either within, you know, on the hilltop of Georgetown or in my small town in Maine. And so getting outside of my comfort zone and being in a place where I had to rely on sort of my basic skills, and I was put into places where I might not have been very comfortable. To me, not only do you feel alive, but you really test who you are. You test your mettle as an individual. And we were tested, actually. I was traveling with a friend of mine at the time, and we had some really scary moments, actually, that reminded us sort of that the world is not a controlled place. It's not a controlled experiment. There are variables, and you need to be able to react to them.
What was one of the crazy stories? Can you
share that? So this turned into my essay for business school. Basically, we took a bus trip that was supposed to be about 12 hours from Bogota, Colombia to Cartagena. And this was in the 90s when the guerrilla was still activating. And so we ended up, it's a little bit of a long story. I ended up writing a Huffington Post blog about it. But we basically went off the road, almost got killed in an accident. We're then searched at gunpoint by, we don't know if it was the paramilitaries or the guerrilla. Then there was a mob that attacked the bus. A lot of things, a lot of stuff went down. And at the end of the experience, what was so valuable is we had to push the bus because it was broken. And I was walking down the aisle of the bus to go push it. And I said to myself, kind of aloud, I said, no lo puedo creer, which means I can't believe it. And this woman looked at me and she was like, creelo y vilo, which means live it and believe it. And I just sort of had this epiphany. I was like, you know, she's so right. Like, this is a challenging moment, but you have nothing to do but simply embrace it and live in the moment and do it. And so we pushed the bus and we made it to Cartagena, and I'm here today to tell you about it.
Wow, that's an incredible story. I love that, live in the moment and just overcome. That's incredible. So what? Any other lessons then from living and immersing yourself at that next level above and beyond traveling?
Yes, absolutely. The number one lesson for me, and something that I firmly believe in and like I absolutely sort of preach to other people, is to learn a language and learn it very, very well. So when I lived in Argentina, I mean, I got there with, I would say, pretty mediocre Spanish. I had high school in Maine, which is shockingly not a great, I mean, I had a good teacher, but it's not like you can practice all the time. 2 years at Georgetown. I got to Argentina and I basically made it my business to learn Spanish like a native. And so by the time I came back, I could pass myself off as an Argentine. And since that time, because of that experience and building those muscles to learn language, I've learned Spanish, Portuguese and French. And so for me, having those languages means that I can go local kind of all over the world, with the exclusion of some parts of the world. But it's been so valuable to my career. Understanding the language and the culture of a place allows you to cut through the bull, as it were, when you start working with people in those places.
Love it. So after Argentina, you came back to America and you joined Wall Street?
I did. So
I came to the Big Apple?
I came to New York City and worked in Latin American investment banking.
Oh, nice. So smooth transition from Argentina back to Wall Street. So what did you do there?
So I did. I got to Wall Street in the late 90s. In 98, I graduated from college and I worked at Chase Bank in the Latin America group in their trade finance group, which was the part I was really into trade. I wanted to be a trade negotiator. That was my dream. I thought I'd go to grad school and become a PhD in economics. But I went to this group and it got eliminated like straight away when I got there. And I was thrown into the general analyst pool.
Oh, no.
Which was scary because I didn't want to be a banker. I was so afraid of that crazy lifestyle. But I managed to weasel my way into Latin America given my language skills. And so I did that for about a year and I hated it. I really, every minute, I thought it was boring. I wasn't good at it. It didn't play to my strengths. So I was getting ready to leave. I actually applied for a Fulbright. And then I was offered the opportunity to interview with a group called Chase Capital Partners, which was the VC group. And so after a year in banking, I somehow improbably found myself doing venture capital in Latin America. And I worked for a woman named Susan Siegel, who all of our co-investments in our deals, we basically brought in this group called Flatiron. So all the companies we invested in, Fred Wilson was also involved with and was on the board. So I went from this investment banking gig, which I hated, to working with this woman, Susan Siegel, who's amazing, and Fred Wilson every day. And it was probably the best education I'll ever have.
And I know most of the audience knows, but for those who don't, who's Fred Wilson?
Fred Wilson is now the managing partner, I think you would say, of Union Square Event.
Union Square, yeah.
And an investor in Tumblr and Foursquare and Twitter and basically all the other awesome companies that you use on a daily basis.
Yeah, I love that. So the last episode, we talked with Adam all about how he hustled his way into a venture capital role at Deep Fork. It's a long journey, and it was a very interesting and exciting journey. So it's interesting now to hear the Wall Street version of finding a way into venture capital. So
I was lucky because I had basically told my boss, I'm done with finance. And then he said, just go meet these people. And I went, I was the only gringo or junkie, as it were, interviewing, but I just got there and they were the smartest people I'd ever met and they were building things and I'd never seen that before. And so I was lucky enough to get hired and that was just a huge break for me.
So that led to a role at AIG, also doing venture capital, right?
Right. So what happened was I ended up going to Harvard Business School after that. And I thought to myself, Latin America became completely out of favor in the meantime, because it just was not a good time for Latin America. And so, and shockingly, and this is the part that was a little bit of a reality check for me, is that nobody really valued my experience in Latin America. When I started interviewing for jobs, they would say, oh, Latin America, like, eh. Did you really do analysis? Sort of like, or did you just sort of stick your finger in the air and see which way the wind was blowing? Which was pretty offensive, considering that we actually probably did more analysis. But we ended up, I ended up finishing business school, and I briefly made a quick stop at a private equity firm in New Jersey, which on month three, I took a nap under my desk and then started looking for a new job because I realized that I was completely bored. And that was a big comeuppance, because you come out of business school and you think you're going to like take over the world, and then you're taking a nap in a suburban New Jersey office park.
Yeah, that doesn't sound ideal.
No, that's like a smack to the coffins, but it was healthy. And then I interviewed and I met these people from AIG Capital that were doing global investing, so all over the world, and basically kind of growth stage and some venture capital and a little bit of private, kind of a lot of different stages of investment. And so I joined them and spent 5 years investing in Pakistan and in Colombia and in Turkey and in China and all over the world.
So what was your experience with, you know, startups? And what stage were you making investments? And, you know, was it pretty early on, or were they later stage companies? Or
so earlier in my career, when I was at Chase Capital and JP Morgan Partners, which was what the firm was called after they merged, we looked at very early stage. We're looking at, you know, there wasn't so much seed investment back then, actually, that, you know, there are many more stages today. But we invested in the Series A of, for example, a company called Mercado Libre, which is now a $5 billion company in Latin America. It's like the eBay of Latin America, largest tech company by far. And we invested at a $7 million pre-money or something like that.
Congrats.
Thank you. Well, unfortunately, I had no carry, but it's a great company, and I'm proud to have it as part of my, I guess, my track record. But that was the kind of stuff we did very, very early stage. Later, when I got to the AIG experience, we did look at things that were pre-revenue, but we also looked at things that were more in the growth stage. So we invested in a BPO and software company that already had revenues, and we invested about $30 million in that. So that was a bit more about like taking something that was working and making it global.
Great. So were you at AIG then in the Capital Partners Group in 2008?
I was
really?
Very much there, yes.
So what happened?
It was a disaster.
So the government bailed them out for $180 billion, correct?
Correct. They bailed out AIG, that is right.
$180 billion.
It's all been repaid, by the way. But yes, it was. This is what happened. Basically, my division had nothing to do with any of the reasons why AIG failed. And I can say that, you know, very clearly, which is inconsequential, really. But what happened was, we were the cool kids in the block. We were the kind of the sexy division of the company. We didn't do insurance like the rest of the company. We did private equity and venture capital, and we had cool offices on Park Avenue, and we traveled all over the place. And it was a great, great job. And I was good at it, and I moved up quickly, and all that was great. But then one day, you know, we were the company, because of many different reasons outside of our control, was caught up in this huge blow up in the financial crisis. And so we, you know, I woke up one day, and basically I had stock that I had bought over the years, and the stock purchase plan was down by 97%. And then the government came in and took over the company, and we were caught up. There was that whole bonus scandal. If you don't know about it, Google it, where basically the government came in and said, we're not going to pay you your bonuses. And oh, by the way, you're evil and terrible people. And then we had protesters outside our buildings, so we couldn't. We basically were told not to carry anything that had the AIG logo on it, lest we be attacked by an angry mob with pitchforks. And so it was crazy for me, because I had done the safe thing. Like, I was this guy from small town America who went to this $1 trillion company. I had a nice job there. It was very stable. And overnight, my choice for stability ended up actually being a complete fail. And so I found myself, my whole worldview was shattered. I just didn't even know how to like think about it.
Yeah,
it
was, how did that impact you?
Well, basically what happened to me was I got super stressed out about the whole thing. I ended up getting really, really sick. They thought I had mono. I couldn't get out of bed for a week. I mean, it was a disaster. And then when I recovered, I basically, you know, it took me like 6 months to recover from this kind of like stress-induced illness. I just couldn't do it anymore. Like, I couldn't get out of bed in the morning to go to the office. I didn't want to be there. I wanted to quit so badly, but I was afraid to quit. So I was caught in this very negative spiral where I just was like hating on the world and I felt like a victim. And it was just, which is not fair either, because lots of people got sort of hurt and lots of people got burned in the financial crisis. So it wasn't the only one for sure, but it was pretty tough.
Yeah. I mean, I want to like zero in on that for a sec. So I think sometimes people don't realize how powerful stress can be at like a biological level. Like, it can build up in the body and just stop you, shut you down.
Oh, for sure. And I think I heard this interesting podcast yesterday on This American Life that in Chinese medicine, there's a strong belief in the connection between physical health, mental health, and emotional health. And if my case is any example, then definitely the emotional and mental stress, it just took me down physically. And it was very interesting, because I'd never really gotten, I was the guy who would be sick and just like power through and never take a day off. And all of a sudden I was laid low, just not in good shape.
Yeah. It catches up with you.
Yeah.
So what do you do now to monitor that? Right. So how do you stay self-aware of that? Going forward, so it doesn't happen again.
I definitely did a couple of things in 2008 that I've maintained and built on that helped me there, because I still have a busy life and I do a lot of things and I'm kind of an energizer bunny, so I don't sleep enough. So I know where I fail, but there's a couple of things I do. Number one is I go to acupuncture once a month.
Okay.
Big believer in acupuncture. I do like yoga, you know, with some frequency. I used to do more. I got really into it after 2008. I ran the marathon, so I run a lot. And then I try to eat, you know, very healthy. So every day I make sure that I take bee pollen, honey, vitamin C, probiotics. So like all these little habits that if you do them every day, remind you to take care of yourself. And so
mentally and what the fuel you put in your body.
Absolutely. And then I'm a napper. I take naps like a bandit.
Nice.
I love my naps. So all of those things together keep
like,
me...
Like 10 minutes, 2 hours?
No, like 2 to 3.
Yeah?
Yeah. I guess that's for some people that's called a sleep. But I like to do a full-on, like, I'll come home at like 6 in the evening and take like a 2.5 hour nap.
Awesome. Well, I want to take a quick partner break, but afterward, I want to talk about your company you started, Real Influence. We're going to get into a lot more about entrepreneurship, the 10% entrepreneur, what you're seeing in the markets, and a lot more. So we'll be right back.
This is Ambition Today with Kevin Sisker. We'll be right back.
Today's partner of Ambition Today is TopTail. Visit toptail.com/ambition today for a free 2-week trial with only the top 3% of software developers and designers. That's toptail.com/ambition today. Ambition Today listeners will receive a no-risk trial period of up to 2 weeks with the top talent in the world. That's what top talent means, top talent. They only work with the top 3% of software developers and designers, fully vetted and ready to be plugged into your existing team right now. If at the end of the trial you're not 100% satisfied, you will not be billed. It's so easy to get started and integrate TopTail into your team. You start the onboarding process at toptail.com/ambition today, and almost immediately someone will connect with you, get you set up, and get someone integrated into your team so they can start making an impact right away. Patrick, have you worked with developers before or hired anyone?
I have, yes.
And what was that process like?
Well, it's difficult, especially if you don't necessarily know where to look. You find yourself running around asking friends. It's very disorganized.
So how important is it to find a good source of talent and optimize that pool of people from the beginning?
It's basically the make or break. I have watched people who have put tens of thousands of dollars into a tech product only to find out that it was garbage.
And what are your thoughts on the importance of people being integrated into your team?
I think it's critical to get people integrated. You need to have somebody, you know, a lot of times I've seen companies work with people outside the team who do a great job, but you need to have somebody on your team who understands what's going on.
Totally agree. So check out TopTail, that's toptail.com/ambition today for a free 2-week trial with only the top 3% of software developers and designers. Also, do not forget to get your Ambition Today stickers. Go to the Ambition Today page on Sisker.co, scroll all the way down to the bottom, and click on stickers. Enter the promo code AMBITION and have your free sticker get mailed to you right away. Once you have your sticker, I want to know where you put it. Tweet me at thesiscar with a picture of where you put it. Last week, Jose of Ward Esports sent me a picture of his sticker on his laptop outside the Flatiron Building in New York City, which was awesome.
You're listening to Ambition Today. Visit us now at ciscar.co.
Welcome back. We are here with Patrick McGinnis talking about how he came up from Maine, went to Wall Street, worked in venture capital, and now we are going to talk about how he became a founder himself. We're going to talk a little bit about how that evolved into his new book, The 10% Entrepreneur. So Patrick, you're after all this time on the investment side, you went to become a founder.
I did.
What was that like, and what was the company called?
It was called Real Influence, and I was kind of dragged into it, I'm going to be honest. I didn't think of myself as somebody who would ever start anything. I was very comfortable investing in startups and taking the risk from a portfolio level. But the idea of doing something where I was, you know, sort of at a principal level and involved on a day-to-day basis was totally foreign to me.
So what did Real Influence do?
So basically, Real Influence is a company that I worked on with my friend Marcelo Camberos. And what it was is a company, that worked with YouTube celebrities to promote branded video. So videos made by, sort of, for example, like a Clorox will make a video and they put it on YouTube. This was 2011, right? So early days of this stuff, and nobody would watch it. And so what we would do would be, we would go to YouTube celebrities and influencers and get them to do an annotation in their video or a shout out and send traffic to the branded video. And then we would do a rev share with the celebrity. It was a great business model in terms of the fact that if you get a $25,000 campaign, you basically split it 50-50 with the celebrity. And so extremely high margin. And so we worked on that business. It was very early. We faced a ton of rejections, major brands.
Was this an interstitial, or was this mixed in like natively with the video?
With a
celebrity's made video.
No, it would be outside. So basically the celebrity would basically just put an annotation that would say, click here if you want to see a cool video. And then you would click and you jump to the brand page.
Okay. No, it's fascinating because I feel like YouTube is at a very exciting point right now. Have you heard of Casey Neistat?
I have, yeah.
So this guy's YouTube videos are incredible. It's a daily vlog, but he's got drone shots and he's got, you know, Canon 70D, 1080 pixel. It's pretty incredible and it's worth checking out. And it's really interesting how you can see people partnering with him throughout the video. It's becoming much more native, I feel.
Yeah, I mean, it's really evolved. This was early days and we were working with people who now, I mean, are household names, but we were talking to people like DJ Tiesto, Austin Mahome. Remember, you know, that guy who's now a huge hit. He's like the new Justin Bieber. And a bunch of other people, and Failblog was one of our partners. And so we would go to brands, and I had good connections with brands, and we would I'd go to talk to them, and we would sell business, and I'd never sold anything in my life. So that was the real value, is that I went into a room and we pitched what was really an idea. I mean, we had kind of, it was a bit like a Band-Aid on the back end in terms of the tech. But my partner had worked at Funny or Die and understood the whole sort of video space. And he was really the primary founder. I came in as a co-founder and worked with him in a part-time nature. So for the first time I did this, I was able to do it part-time. It was basically paid with, you know, advisory equity and then a share of any business that I brought to the table. But we did it together and I watched and learned from him. He's a tremendous, tremendous founder. And so it was kind of an education, a paid education in entrepreneurship.
What was that like the first time you sold something? Especially because as an investor, you're a buyer. You're buying equity in exchange for cash, right? You have a budget, you can spend it and buy things. So what was that like to sit on the other side of the table the first time you sold something?
Well, it was very terrifying because I was very uncomfortable with the fact that we were selling something that wasn't fully baked. We knew what we were going to do and we'd find a way to make it work through, you know, working out different, let's say, partnerships if we needed to drive some traffic. But we didn't have everything figured out. And so we're sitting there pitching a product that I didn't know if it was going to work. And we ended up meeting with a friend of mine from college, and she worked at a liquor company, and they were willing to put $25,000 of experimental capital into a deal and basically see if it worked. And so when we sold that, I remember very well, we're in their offices and I stepped into the elevator and I started jumping up and down because I'd never sold anything in my life. And so that was great. And then it turned into terror because I wasn't sure we could actually deliver on it. And so I found that, that's very common in tech, right? I mean, that's kind of how you build businesses, but right. getting comfortable with the concept that it wasn't sort of an established service cost a lot of sort of like stress for me.
It gave you some gray hairs for sure.
For sure.
You don't have gray hair. Right? So what was your key lesson you took away from your time as a founder?
So what I learned, I learned three things. Number one, I learned how to sell, as we just discussed. Number two, I learned that I could do something in a part-time capacity and actually have a meaningful experience. And number three is I learned the value of partnering people with people who could complement my skills and really teach me and expand me as an entrepreneur and push me out of my comfort zone.
Can you expand on that last one a little bit?
Yeah. So Marcelo, who is a great friend of mine, he pushed me every day. I mean, he was a very good friend to me, and I'm very thankful for it. I would get frustrated easily, I would say. I would get a little nervous. I mean, I'm a little anxious in these types of things. And he just pushed me through it. He would say, man, focus on the critical path, and here's what we're going to do, and don't worry about this. I'll take care of these things. You focus on yours. And I just found that to be very, it was very, very helpful because I was just operating outside of an area where I knew what to do. And so I trusted him. And because I trusted him, I was able to sort of go with the flow and listen to him, you know, when he told me to keep going.
I think that's important because as an entrepreneur, sometimes it feels like you're walking and it's pitch black out and you don't see where you're going, right? But then you have this other person, maybe it's a mentor, maybe it's a partner who has been down that road, right? And sees it so clear, right? And you almost just have to trust that mentorship and feedback because you don't know what you don't know. And
yeah.
You need to grow and get those experiences.
Yeah. And it's funny. I think about that's absolutely true. And I think there's kind of a two-way street to it. And you'd have to ask Marcelo, but I think the fact that I was willing to sort of join him and be part of the team, probably from his perspective, was gratifying because it's like, okay, there's this guy that I respect who's going to help me and work hard with me on something that is still kind of a PowerPoint deck in many ways. And so we both brought something to the table that made our efforts way more successful.
So what is the 10% entrepreneur?
10% entrepreneur. So after that experience with Real Influence, I had this epiphany that I could spend part of my time doing things on the side, investing, advising, and getting involved, even founding companies. And so I started doing that. I started basically talking to people. People would approach me with things. You know, if you're talking to people, if you're in the flow in the startup world, you see lots of opportunities, but you know, you may like something, but you're not necessarily going to jump in full time. And so what I decided to do was to start getting involved in lots of different things and build a portfolio of things on the side. And so that's what the book came from. The idea was basically let me set aside 10% of my time and if possible, 10% of my capital to do things on the side in an entrepreneurial fashion.
So I want to challenge you on this a little bit. So, you know, so many entrepreneurs are taught you need to be all in, right? Mm-hmm. Or it's just never going to work. You're the one bleeding it. You need to have the passion. You need to be there hustling every day to make this thing work. It's your child. So how can you or how can people only give 10% and still find success in entrepreneurship, I guess.
Right. It's a great question and a very fair question. And it's not the first time I've heard this question. So let me unpack it a little bit for you.
Okay.
The first thing is it depends on how you're going to engage as an entrepreneur. So if you're an angel investor or an advisor, that can be your 10%. And I think you'd agree that that's not a full-time sort of enterprise, right? You do those things on the side.
Right.
But let's look specifically at the case of a founder. Let's think about, for example, there's a guy named Peter Barlow who's in the book, who's a founder of Silver Car. Silver Car is a car rental company that Austin Ventures invested in, Eduardo Saverin invested in. It's they've raised about $50 million in capital, and it's a great business.
What do they do?
They are, imagine if you take traditional car rental and then fix everything that stinks about it and make it automated. It's all through an app. They're okay. All silver Audis and they're basically like you get a silver Audi for basically the price of like what you pay for like an enterprise, you know, midsize or something. So they're all over the country now. Great company. Peter was a lawyer. He had left his law firm twice to work at startups. Both failed. And so he was like, you know, listen, I love the startup thing, but I've been kind of put through the ringer with this kind of stuff. And I don't want to give up. I want the stability of a day job. But he was on a plane one day and he was a transportation lawyer. He had done deals with airplanes. He'd done deals with cars. He met a guy who was starting Silver Car, and this guy had been trying to fundraise. He had not had any success. And so he basically, Peter said, listen, I have this idea. I know a bunch of people in this space. Why don't we sit down on the whiteboard and build a business plan, which they did. Peter then helped this guy, his partner, find many more partners, helped him find fundraising, helped him with the business model, helped him kind of do everything, all while keeping his day job. And so even though he has a founder stake and he's invested in every round, he never had to leave his job. So that's one example. And then there are lots of examples, like a guy named Luke Holden, who started Luke's Lobster, which is a company that, if you like lobster.
I love Luke's Lobster.
Okay, Luke's Lobster is my—
Lobster rolls are the best food on the planet.
And good for you too, by the way. Very good for you.
I love lobster rolls.
So this makes—
if you haven't tried a lobster roll, go find a lobster shop in New York City, Red Hook, Luke's. They're delicious.
Yes, I want one after this. But Luke was working on Wall Street.
We'll get lobster rolls for lunch.
Fine, done.
Done.
Luke was working for on Wall Street, started this on the side. He brought in a partner early on who could spend the day, because he was like working all the time. He brought in a partner who could do the day-to-day operations. He was, but still he was like the prime mover in the business. He raised the money, he built the business plan. And then he only left his Wall Street job when they had opened their second store. So as a founder, I agree. If you're going to scale this to a $1 billion business and raise capital and do all kinds of things, then you need to eventually jump in full time. But there are lots of ways to get involved before then and still be entrepreneurial.
So how did the book deal come about for the 10% entrepreneur?
So if you want a book deal—
how does one get a book deal?
Right. My example is so long tail. I don't know if you could ever take any lessons from it, but I'll try to see if I can tease them out. So I started writing for myself. After this whole AIG thing, I was basically using writing as some therapeutic kind of way of sorting out.
Privately, or you're blogging externally, or everything?
Privately in the beginning.
Okay.
And then I had lunch with a friend of mine named Kirsten Bartok. And Kirsten is an amazing human being. She's been an investor and an entrepreneur and all kinds of stuff like that. And she understands sort of content creation because she's built this kind of content vertical for herself in the area where she works. And she said to me one day, pick one thing you want to be known for and write about it. And so at the time I was traveling a lot and I was interested in travel. So I started writing about travel for my hometown newspaper in Maine, just for fun, as a creative outlet. But then I sent some of my posts into the Huffington Post and I started blogging for them. And then as I did that, I started expanding into tech, into business, and just kind of using that as a fun place to write. Meanwhile, writing privately for myself about this AIG stuff and what I had learned from that and the lessons and how to build a career that was diversified and all these other concepts. So I had a bunch of writings, and then a friend of mine at a failing tech company who was desperate and miserable and was wondering what to do with his life. I basically was talking to him one day and I gave him my writings and he said, well, my best friend is a literary agent. You should talk to her because I really like what you're saying here. So I met her. She was over in London. We had a call. She said, listen, I'm not going to read all your stuff. Write a proposal. So I wrote a proposal. She gave me notes on it. I turned it again. And then basically she signed me as a client. And I didn't realize that I didn't really know who she was or who this agency was. But I happened to be over in London and I went to their office and there was like a picture of Kate Winslet and Eddie Redmayne on the wall. And I realized that I just signed with the largest agency in Europe.
Wow. Nice. So congrats.
Thank you. So I thought, well, here we go. Like, I'm going to have a book in no time, right? Well, unfortunately for me, or I don't know how you characterize it, we sent out the proposal and we got rejected by like 33 publishing houses. Everybody, there, and I think the first idea that we had for the book, which I won't go into, was an earlier kind of iteration, was pretty negative, and it was kind of a ranty, like anti-Wall Street thing, and nobody wants to read you sort of like with an axe to grind on the page. Like, it's just not interesting, right?
Right.
So the feedback was, why don't you take this and make it a little bit more positive, which at that point, I was doing a lot of 10% stuff. So I started writing that and I wrote that proposal and we sent it out. And then we were just ignored. And then because, I don't have a quote unquote platform, right? I don't have, I'm not famous. I'm not on TV. I'm not this, I'm not that. Until one day I got a call from a reporter who said, I'm writing an article about the origins of the term FOMO, or fear of missing out. And I've traced that back to you.
Interesting. So wait, are you saying that you created or coined the term FOMO?
I'm saying that. I'm saying basically that I wrote an article.
And real quick, what does FOMO mean for the audience that doesn't know?
Fear of missing out.
Okay.
So I was in business school in 2004. I wrote this article for our little newspaper. And then, you know, basically it was not used again on the internet for like 3 years. And so if you trace it back, you know, I'm the first guy to use it. And so
that's fascinating.
It is. And that's the value of content creation.
And you didn't know this until this reporter did all this due diligence and contacted you.
Right. I didn't really realize it because, you know, we used it. It came from my friend group. So we all kind of used the word. But I thought it was special. And I remember thinking, like, this is interesting. Like, I've never heard this before. And so I wrote the article that sort of preserves it. And so this reporter, Ben Schreckinger, wrote about it. And then it went kind of viral. This story kind of went viral. And then I got a call a week later to go into Penguin's offices in New York to meet with them about a book deal based on my proposal. And then, you know, that was it. We signed the book deal and we were off to the races.
Awesome. That's incredible.
Yeah.
What's the name of that blog post? Is it still up for people to check out?
It is there. You can find it. I'll tell you my site later. You can link to it there. Or you can just Google McGinnis and FOMO. But there's an article in Boston Magazine. And then the original article is in the Harbis, which is the Harvard Business School newspaper. And it's called McGinnis's Two Foes, Social Theory at HBS. Because I talk about FOMO and what's called FOBO, or fear of a better option, which is another really terrible thing that can ruin your life.
FOBO. All right. I like that. Maybe that'll be like the new term.
FOBO is way worse than FOMO. So I want people to surface FOBO as much as possible.
All right. Awesome. So let's jump to the Ambition Today question of the day. So today's Ambition Today question of the day is a little long, but it's around what was the gold standard norm of jobs when you were growing up that everyone around you accepted as a good job, but you maybe challenged the status quo?
It's a great question. And I come from a place where I come from a small town in Maine where people thought about the role of work in their life really differently than we do in a place like New York or people, you know, I think even do today in many parts of the country, given the fact that you can work from anywhere these days. People worked to pay the bills. So they would leave the office at night and that was kind of it. There was no checking of email. There was no thinking about what you did during the day. It was sort of like, go home and spend time with your family or do your leisure pursuits or whatever. So as a kid, my parents certainly had fine jobs, but they didn't ever talk about sort of their quote unquote like occupation or their vocation when they got home at night. They talked about the office politics and what happened and, you know, the scandals. What I did see was people who had small businesses. And so you'd see the person who ran the Dairy Queen or, you know, the diner, but we didn't think about that as entrepreneurship. I never heard the word entrepreneur as a kid. And so I think for me, what I was able to do, thanks to my educational experiences and all these other things, is I was able to get a good job that taught me a bunch of stuff. But then later, thankfully, I was able to break out of the mindset of security, because I was one of these people who would have never tried doing anything entrepreneurial had I not been through this experience where basically security was an illusion for me and I had to learn how to hustle to find my own path.
Once you started breaking out, was there a reaction or were other people who are still in that mindset like, what is he doing here? Like what's going on?
Oh, most definitely. I mean, I think people for several years were like, what is he doing? You know, my parents are very supportive and my family's supportive. It's been fine on that front. But I would go up to my, you know, my hometown and try to explain to people what the heck I was up to. And people were just like, do you work? or even the book thing. Like, people were like, oh, like, the book's on Amazon. I can't believe it. And I'm sort of like, yeah, like this is like a real thing. It's not this, I'm not just like sort of like, you know, writing this down and photocopying it and posting it, you know, to, you know, some random Russian, you know, porn site. Like, this is a real thing. I'm doing this, you know. I think people just didn't know how to think about doing something that's a little bit non-standard, let's say.
It is interesting for sure seeing that reaction, especially when you kind of come out of that ecosystem.
Well, I think you have to learn, and I mean, this is kind of an obvious point, but I'll trace it back to my childhood. When I was a kid, I had terrible Tourette syndrome. I was like shaking all the time. I blinked my eyes. It was a total disaster. Okay. And I was made fun of all the time by that, by my peers, because I was very different and I stuck out pretty badly. As a result, I just learned pretty early in life not to really care what people thought. And I think not caring, I mean, you want to have great people who can tell you when you're on the wrong path. And who can say to you, and I had friends who say to me, you know, I'm really concerned that you don't know what you're doing. Do you know what you're doing? Or how can I help you? Things like that. But in terms of doing things that you believe in that may not be sort of the norm or that aren't like quote unquote successful for other people, you need to just shut it down and basically focus on what's going to get you forward. And if you can do that, you know, then you're in the right place.
That's a great lesson. And it's interesting that it was just so ingrained in you to swim against the stream that it just became natural, right? And I think people don't really always realize that they're just getting swept away by the current and how important it is to take a step back and go after your goals and challenge the norms to follow your ambition.
Yeah, I think, and I've seen this with a number of friends I know who have been, you know, successful or who have done something a little different, is a little adversity as a kid. It's not fun at the time, but I think overcoming obstacles when you're young, it teaches you something that is very valuable later. If you see somebody who has the charmed life and then all of a sudden something crappy happens when they're in their 20s, it's much harder to rebound, I think. So it is, you know, tapping into that resiliency is really important.
Resilience is definitely the key word there. And yeah, learning resilience young, I think, is what signals a lot of strong entrepreneurs.
Yes, for sure.
All right. Well, I wanted to thank you for coming on. Before we wrap, a few quick notes to everyone. Please review the show on iTunes. If you go to siskar.co/review, it will take about 3 minutes of your time, if that, and it tremendously helps us. So thank you, and thank you for listening. As always, think of one other person who has some serious hustle and just text them this episode. Click that little box with the arrow coming out of it on your phone, text us to them, and have them take a listen. Lastly, Patrick, how cool are these stickers?
I'm going to definitely stick mine somewhere where I can see it every day, like in my office or something.
Nice. I love it. All right. So I want to thank you for coming on. Thank you. Where can people find The 10% Entrepreneur?
So you can find it at all good bookstores, Amazon.com and Barnes & Noble and Audible as well. It's an audiobook now.
Audiobook?
It nice. Is.
Audible sponsors this podcast.
Well, Audible is amazing. And my copy of the audio, I didn't read it. So if you don't like my voice, you don't have to hear it. But the guy who
sure,
read
it's
it,
great.
He was on Broadway. He's a really accomplished actor. And it came out. It's beautiful. So enjoy it at Audible. And you can find
audible.com,
audible.com,
audibletrial.com/ambition today.
Perfect.
And get Patrick's book, The 10% Entrepreneur, as your free book.
That's right. And you can also find more about me at patrickmcginnis.com, where you will also find a free chapter of the book. You can find a quiz that'll help you figure out how to become a 10% entrepreneur and which kind is relevant to you.
Very cool.
And you can read more about, you know, what this is all about. And I hope that you will become part of our community. You can actually sign up for time to talk to me even.
Great. I love it. Well, thank you again for coming on. Everyone listening, stay curious as always, and we will see everyone next time on the next episode of Ambition Today.
Thanks for listening to this episode of Ambition Today with your host, Kevin Siskar. For more great content and to stay up to date, visit www.siskar.co. We'll catch you next time.